October 20th of 2020. So it's 10/20/2020. And we're going to look at the subject, Old Man Nature versus Possession. The reason I did this teaching a few years ago and then included it is because sometimes people get a little carried away with the devil spirit filled, so to speak, discerning of spirits. And we're going to look at the Word of God and see what it has to say on this particular subject. Okay. So the manifestation of discerning of spirits is your operation of the God-given ability whereby you may receive from God, by His revealing it to you, the necessary information concerning the presence or non-presence of spirits, and when needed, the identity of spirits present, and if evil, whether you may cast them out. So there's an updated definition. So is there a spirit present? See, it's to discern, detect, or to be made aware of their presence and to determine their identity. They may be spirits of the Diablos, the devil. They may be spirits, you know, the Holy Spirit, or could be the spirit of man, meaning one soul life. It is not the casting out of devils. This may happen after you are aware of what is present spiritually. This would require the manifestation of working of miracles. It is not discernment. It's not discerning of faults. It's not imagination. It's not fortune telling, utilizing any of the adversary's disguises. But it will tell you what spirits in the fortune teller. It's not ESPN. Yeah, it's not ESPN. It's not even ESP. It's not parapsychology, psychocybernetics, or Christian Science. Now, this manifestation covers in the spirit realm what word of knowledge and word of wisdom cover in the natural realm. It is revealed to you to make you aware of spiritual conditions that are prevalent. When one or more devils control the mind or body of an individual, the Bible refers to it as possession. The individual is controlled by the spirit to act a certain way. There is no freedom of will. There is no choice. The person is not in control. The spirit is. So let's consider what God has recorded in His Word regarding man's first transgression against Him, the time of the original sin. We go to Genesis chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, has God said you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God does know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. So, is possession by the spirit mentioned, by the serpent mentioned? Is possession by the serpent mentioned? No. It was a discourse between a woman and the seducing serpent, who happened to be, you know, the devil had possessed the serpent, but it was a discourse between the two. And when the woman saw, so she's invoking five senses. She saw the tree was good for food and that it was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise. She took of the fruit thereof and did eat and gave also unto her husband with her and he did eat. Again, is possession mentioned? No. Devilish influence? Absolutely. This verse stated that Eve saw three things. First, she utilized her senses in seeing that the tree was good for food, and then that it was pleasant to the eyes. And finally, she saw that it was a tree to be desired to make one wise. She saw, then acted. She saw by imploring her five senses. Then she acted on that information. She deliberately disobeyed God. She weighed the evidence and made a decision based on the senses, not by the spirit. Verse 7. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, made themselves aprons, And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden by the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked and I hid myself." They were afraid. They hid themselves by free will, not by possession. Fear and broken fellowship are still of disobedience, of sinning, of not doing the will of God. So what was the result here? Fear. Do you ever have a relationship with somebody who keeps running away from you? All right, verse 11. And he said, "Who told you you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree that I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat?" I love the way God plays along with this whole record. And the man said, obviously, the woman that you gave me. I was perfectly happy with TV dinners, leisure suits, and just living my life. And you brought this woman to me. It's her fault. The woman that you gave to be with me. She gave me of the tree and I did eat. Adam freely ate. He made a decision by utilizing his free will. He gauged the facts and made a decision based on the senses evidence, not because he was under the control of any spirit. He willfully disobeyed. Devilish information was involved in the facts he gathered, but he, by his own choice, made the decision to walk by the flesh and not by the spirit. Verse 13, so God plays along and he says to the woman, "What is this that thou hast done?" And the woman said, "The serpent beguiled me and I did eat." All right, the serpent beguiled or seduced Eve. It did not possess her. She decided her course of action by free will. This is still the standard mode of operation the adversary utilizes. He uses subtlety to try to deceive the believer away from Christ. 2 Corinthians 11:3, very clear. "But I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled or deceived Eve through his subtlety," through his craftiness is how he was able to get away with it. So Paul, God's telling Paul to write this so that people will be aware that, so that their minds or their thinking processes should be corrupted from the simplicity or the integrity and purity that is in Christ. People will start moving away from Christ. And he's reminding people that that's what happened with Eve. Now, Matthew 4:24 mentions many sick people, but only a portion of the sick were possessed with devils. Here, let's look at Matthew 4:24. "And his fame went throughout all Syria, and they brought unto him all sick people that were taken with many diseases and torments." So they had diseases and torments. "And then also there were some that were possessed with devils, and then there was lunatics and palsy, and he healed them." You see, the devil is the author or the instigator of circumstances, which he uses to confront Christians with indirectly. Satan, as the great accuser of the true God's children, is the indirect cause of people's problems by way of him orchestrating situations, circumstances, or other people, which he arranges and controls. His influence is behind their actions. 2 Corinthians 12:7, great example. "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure." Was Satan himself Paul's thorn in the flesh? Not by direct involvement, but indirectly through having his messenger influence and at times possess people to hinder Paul. Before a person gets born again of God's Spirit, he is more susceptible to the ideas of the devil. Until a person is born again of God's Spirit, he walks according to the standards of the world, which the God of this world has orchestrated. Look at Ephesians 2:2 and 3. "Wherein, in time past, you walked according to the course of this world." You walked according to the course of this world. You walked according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation. We all had our manner of life in times past, in the cravings or lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. Our behavior was according to the world's standards. Our nature as body and soul, men and women, our nature was as a child of wrath, whose actions were to do the desires of the flesh only. One had no choice. Since he had no spirit, he could only walk or live according to the world's standard, by the senses. This is the nature of body and soul man. They are born into the world this way, without spirit. They are easily manipulated, but not necessarily possessed. They are blown about by every wind of doctrine, influenced by Satan, to keep them from receiving the gift of Holy Spirit, and to stop them from receiving accurate information that would help them to walk with and for the true God. 1 Corinthians 2:14. But the natural man, the man of body and soul, he cannot receive the things of the Spirit. They're just foolishness. He looks at them and they're foolishness unto him. Neither can he know them, because the only way he can know things of the Spirit is by spiritually discerning them or spiritually examining them. If you don't have the Spirit, you can't spiritually examine them. Now, in the book of Galatians, God lists the works of the flesh. Devilish influences exist. However, a person does not necessarily need to be possessed to do them. These are manifested forth because they are part of the old man nature. The natural man, a man of body and soul, will by nature do these things. It's all he can do. It's his nature. These will be the fruit of his actions. Possession by devil spirits may happen, but it is not always a direct cause. Galatians 5:16, working translation. Now I say, walk by means of the Spirit, and you will in no way carry out the craving of the flesh. Two opportunities if you've got the Spirit. Only one, it's your nature if you don't have the Spirit. When you walk by means of the Spirit, you will not act on the cravings of the flesh. They are contrary the one with the other. The born-again one, not God or the devil, will to do it. They decide to do it. They will to do it. This is the purpose of the renewed mind. It is to take in information and make the right decision according to what God says in his word, or in certain circumstances, by revelation, not to walk by the world. Verse 17, in fact, the flesh craves against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these things are opposed to each other, with the result that you do not do what you desire to do. However, if you are being led by means of the Spirit, then you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident, which are fornication, uncleanness, unbridled lust, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, strife, jealousies, hot tempers, factitious strifes, division, sex, envy, some texts add murders, drunkenness, carousing, and such things like these. I say ahead of time, even as I said previously, that they practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God, because these are the works of the flesh. They're not born again. It's just the flesh. They don't have the Spirit. That's why they won't inherit the kingdom of God. God then lists the attributes that one would see when they walk by the new nature, once they are born again. Again, it is free will and not possession when one chooses to not walk after the Spirit. Verses 22 to 26 from the Working Translation. However, the fruit of the Spirit, these will be evident when one walks by the Spirit. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, believing, meekness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. Those who belong to Christ have already crucified the flesh with the sufferings and the cravings. Since we are alive by means of the Spirit, then by means of the Spirit, let us also walk with orderly conduct. Let us not become conceited, provoking one another, envying one another. See, you see the fruit of the old man and the fruit of one who can walk for God, who has the Spirit. Now, in Ephesians 4, God presents the actions of the old man and the new man. Both have free will. The man who listens to or abides in the world versus the man who lives by his new spirit nature that is born within him at the time of the new birth makes the decision on how to live his life. Devil spirits do not need to possess to have the works of the flesh manifest themselves. It is the nature of the old man. The old man nature will manifest itself because that is its nature, its makeup, its seed. It does not need any prodding by devil spirits. It will happen automatically because that's the fruit of the old man nature. It is by free will. Now, the true God never possesses anyone to get his work accomplished. His children walk in their new nature of love and by freedom of will choose to do his will. Devil spirits do not have the power to enter into anyone anytime they like, unless the person is born of the devil, has the devil seed in them, or the individual allows them. He's got so comfortable with it, the devil knows it has come and go. The devil is looking for an opening. He cannot come in and control at will. 1 Peter 5:8. Be sober, be vigilant, or be watchful. Because your adversary, you have a personal adversary. Because your adversary, the slandering devil, as a roaring lion, he's walking about seeking whom he may devour. God's child is exhorted to be spiritually sober, vigilant, on where he receives his information to live by. He can live above the darts of the wicked one because he has already triumphed through the accomplished work of Christ. 2 Corinthians 2:14. Now, thanks be unto God, who always causes or always leads us in triumph in Christ and makes manifest the fragrance, the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. As you walk around, you smell good spiritually. The born-again believer has the power to overcome the adversary, to not allow him to have control of his life. It is still based on free will, though. He can be tempted and enticed away from God. The individual is drawn away by his lust and enticed by devil spirit influences, but not possessed. James 1:14 through 16 in the Working Translation. Each person is tempted when he is allured and enticed by his own cravings. Then, when the craving has conceived, it bears sin, and the sin, when it has reached its final course, gives birth to death. Do not be misled, my beloved brothers. There is no record of direct dealing with devil spirits in the church epistles, the part of God's word that is addressed to us today. This indicates that possession is the exception rather than the rule. There are a few records in the book of Acts, so the believer is to be aware of their presence, but they are not to be the focal point of his walk with God. God's supposed to be the focal point of your walk with God. Many times the one who has devils on the mind is the one carrying them about. You get some people who are all into a devil spirit behind every driver. Well, now, that may be true, but that's not really what we're talking about here. Okay. So, it's because everybody's possessed, all this stuff is happening. No, not even in Washington, D.C., everybody's possessed. Okay. But somebody who has devils on the mind all the time, they're the ones many times that, it's the devils who are constantly making him aware of all this stuff. So is it something we know we need to be aware of, something we need to deal with? Absolutely. Something we need to be overly concerned about? No. Acts 19:8, and when he went into the synagogue, he spoke boldly for the space of 3 months, disputing or reasoning and persuading the things concerning the kingdom of God. This was Paul's manner of entering in. He taught the word about the kingdom of God. And when divers were hardened and believed not, but spoke evil of that way before the multitude, he withdrew from them and he separated the disciples, reasoning daily in the school of one Tyrannus. And this continued by the space of 2 years, so that all they which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus, both Jews and Greeks. And God wrought special or uncommon miracles by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or work aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. The teaching of God's word about the accomplished work of Christ was the catalyst that led to the deliverance of many. Verse 13, we see an interesting result. He's teaching about the kingdom of God, about the accomplished work of Christ, being delivered. Then certain of the vagabond or wandering Jews, in verse 13, exorcists, took upon them to call over them that had evil spirits the name of the Lord Jesus, saying, "We adjure you by Jesus whom Paul preaches." Now, an exorcist is one who exorcises devil spirits, evil spirits, usually by having a larger devil spirit that commands the lesser devil spirits to obey him. These Jews are trying to be like the great apostle Paul and demonstrate the power and control that they thought they really had, you know. And they were the seven sons of one Sceva, who's a Jew, who's the chief of the priests, which did so. And the evil spirit answered and said, "Well, Jesus I'm pretty familiar with. And Paul, yeah, I've had to deal with him too. But who are you?" And the man in whom the evil spirit was leaped or jumped on them and overpowered them, 1 on 7, and prevailed against them so that they fled out of the house naked and wounded. See, the seven sons of Sceva were involved with something they had little understanding of. They had no idea what they were doing. In fact, they were just being used by the adversary to try to mock the power of God. Instead, God utilized this incident for his glory. The devil spirit they were utilizing, the seven sons of Sceva, was a lower-ranking devil spirit than the spirit that was in the man. And that so outraged the higher-ranking spirit that he trashed the seven sons of the chief priest. It recognized the spiritual order of authority in the spiritual realm. There are many records in the Bible emphasizing free will decisions by the believer. He is responsible for his actions. It's too easy to blame all his shortcomings on, "The devil made me do it," instead of taking responsibility for his own actions. Satan is the god of this age, but his power is limited. He cannot possess the Christian at will. The old man nature is the cause of most problems in a believer's life, including their children. There are many verses in the Bible that inform us that we are to instruct our children in the ways of God. If they are not instructed properly, they do not get possessed, but rather they live by the old man nature and reap the consequences of their unbelief, just like adults do. If you're not training the children properly, then all they can do is what their nature is. 1 John 2, 14 to 17, Working Translation. "I have written unto you, little children," or young students, "because you have known the Father. I have written to you, fathers, because you have known him who is from the beginning. I have written to you, young men, because you are strong and the word of God is abiding in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. Do not love the world, nor the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. Because everything in the world, the craving of the flesh, the craving of the eyes, and the boastful arrogance of the earthly life, is not from the Father, but is from the world. Furthermore, the world and its cravings are passed away, but he who makes a practice of the will of God abides forever." We are responsible for our actions. We stay in control of our lives. We put on the mind of Christ, and we decide whether or not to renew our minds to act in the will of God. There is a devil, and he wants to deceive us. He wants to keep us under condemnation, under sin consciousness, so that we will not manifest our sonship rights, privileges, and spiritual abilities. He wants us to be too ashamed or too conscious of our shortcomings so that we will not even think we're worthy enough to live for him. We need to not let the road downhill get into a position of control in our lives. When we see or hear of division or lack of concern, we need to address the truths from God's word. When there is rejection of reproof and focus on personality traits and intense questioning of others' decisions, We need to realize the evil one is at work with his fiery darts and come to the Word of God and humble ourselves to acknowledge the will of God. We need to learn the secret to a holy life and to get our eyes off of our own inadequacies and unto the Father in his glory. To walk worthily is to walk with thanksgiving to God, seeking his will first and foremost. Our love and labor is to him because of who he has made us in Christ. We are already well-pleasing to God, so we can live a life of service joyfully to our God who cares for us and protects his children. If you are walking with and for the one true God, you may need to cast devils out of those who are trying to hinder you with the Father. You never know when somebody's going to show up at your business and you have to deal with it. In nearly all the records of deliverance, the teaching or preaching of God's word preceded the manifestation of Holy Spirit. Our primary objective is to hold forth the word of God and to speak the truth in love. We proclaim God's kindness and goodness and the availability of deliverance. Ephesians 4:15, Working Translation. In contrast, as we speak the truth in love, let us grow up in all ways in him who is the head, even Christ. And from the English Standard Version, Romans 2:5 says, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance. 2 Timothy 4:1 and 2 from the Working Translation, I testify before God in Christ Jesus, who's going to judge the living and the dead, even by appearing in his kingdom, herald the word. Stand ready when it is convenient and when it is not convenient. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. Those who are in need respond to the preaching of deliverance and come for help because they have a genuine desire and expectation to be set free. One does not need to go looking for people to heal or to cast devil spirits out. There will be plenty of opportunities to manifest God's power if you are speaking God's word boldly and consistently. If you decide to get involved spiritually, there'll be a supply of those who have a need. You do the healing or the casting out of devil spirits. You do not pray to God to cast out the devils for you. You must perform the casting out of the devil spirit or spirits. You do it believing. As you begin to minister, God's Spirit in you will give you the necessary information to accomplish the task. What to do, what to say, and if and how you're to touch the person. Philippians 2:13, for it is God which works in you, both the will and to do of his good pleasure. When one who is possessed or his family believes for the deliverance, if the person can't handle it himself, the one who casts out the devil's spirit or spirits believes in his authority over the devil's spirits and orders them to go out of the person. Our attitude against them is important. Both those who desire healing and the one who casts out devils must expect deliverance. The individual requiring deliverance and the person performing the healing or casting out a spirit must believe sufficiently to receive. When a devil spirit in a person disturbs you by crying out, shouting, or speaking to prevent what you wish to do in a meeting or in your daily routine, then you can order it to get out of that person. When a devil spirit disturbs you, you do not need someone else, like his parents or family member, to believe for them to get the devils out. The woman who had the python spirit disturbing the meeting, bam, gone. Sometimes, though, all you need to do is control the spirit with your God-given authority without removing them. You may need to command them to be quiet or not to be a disruption. Sometimes you have a person at work or somebody you're around and you know there's a spirit there, but if the spirit gets cast out, it's coming right back. So basically, you, because of the power of God, you can control the spirit to not disrupt, to not operate in certain situations. You don't necessarily have to get rid of them, but you can command them not to be active. Acts 13. And when they had gone through the island of Paphos, they found a certain sorcerer, a false prophet, a Jew whose name was Bar-Jesus, which was with the proconsul of the country, Sergius Paulus, prudent man, who called for Barnabas and Saul, and he called for them because he wanted to hear the word of God. But Elymas the sorcerer, for so is his name by interpretation, withstood them, seeking to turn away the deputy from the faith or from the right way of believing. Then Saul, who is also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, set his eyes on him. And he looked at him steadfastly and said, O ye of all, full of subtlety or full of deceitfulness, full of all mischief, thy child of the devil, thy enemy of all righteousness. And that's usually not what you do, talking to one of the proconsul's helpers or assistant or guidant, you know, to speak that way to them. But see, this is by revelation. You enemy of all righteousness, wilt thou not cease to pervert the right ways of the Lord? And now, behold, the hand of the Lord is upon thee, and thou shalt be blind, not seeing the sun for a season, for a while, and immediately it fell on him a mist and a darkness. He went about seeking some to lead him by the hand. Then the deputy, when he saw what was done, he believed, being astonished at the doctrine of the Lord. So Paul and Barnabas, they didn't go looking for a fight, but when they found it, they operated revelation to put that man out of control, so that they were able then to teach the proconsul, the one who wanted to hear the word of God. When a person is delivered from devil spirit possession, instruct them from God's word so they can remain delivered. 8:35, then they went out to see what was done and came to Jesus and found the man out of whom the devils were departed, and he was sitting at the feet of Jesus. He's clothed. He's in his right mind. And they were more afraid of that than when he was in the tombs. When God gives you revelation concerning a spirit, he will do it clearly and in the context of your understanding, experiences, or knowledge. Do not fear them. As you act, you will have the guidance and the boldness to take them out if they are there. You know, you can't throw a dog out of the house if there's no dog there. Other than that, that went the hard way. As you know, I thought there was a spirit present. There wasn't. It was just an unrenewed seventh grader. It happened to be one of my students. As you act, you will know what is there and what to do by the operation of the manifestation of discerning of spirits. You do not necessarily have to name them in order to cast them out. Jesus did not with the man who had many daimonia. You can throw all of them out at once by the authority and power of God in Christ in you, and command them not to return.